going to open the public hearing on House Bill 215 and recognize the prime sponsor, Representative Cushing.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. For the record, I'm Representative Rennie Cushing from Rockingham 21, out of Canada. 2 years ago, Representative John Connors and I were at Seattle, Washington at the National Conference of State Legislators Annual Convention. John is on the Agricultural Committee and Criminal Justice Committee. And we found ourselves on a field trip to marijuana processing facility because Washington at the time had decided to do referendum to legalize, regulate, and tax that. And that was an eye-opening field trip. The bill before you is to establish a commission to study the legalization, taxation, regulation of marijuana. I think we're at an interesting time in our country right now where 20% of the state, 20% of the population lives in states where adult use of marijuana is legal. Again, we know what just happened last November in Massachusetts and Maine. Canada is moving toward legalization of marijuana. Our neighboring state of Vermont has a piece of legislation on to deal with that. What this commission, the intent of this commission is to have a New Hampshire look at issues relating to marijuana, whether or not we should treat marijuana the way that we treat the use of alcohol. I always think I thought it would be important to get stakeholders at the table. There's some reference to the earlier bill that we had on decriminalization. And this study commission does that. It allows for members of the House and Senate, obviously, the Attorney General, the Commission of Safety, of Health and Human Services, Revenue Administration, Agriculture. You know, it has a representation for the Chiefs of Police and the Civil Liberties Union, New Futures, which deals with addiction issues, Bar Association Marijuana Policy Project, and the Farm Bureau, and of course, appointees by the government. It has a kind of a specific charge. It sunsets, which is always a good thing. The hope from this is that we would be able to have New Hampshire take a comprehensive and thoughtful examination of marijuana policy. I know others will speak further to it, but are there any questions?
Okay.
I recognize also you had another bill related to set up a commission, but that, I believe that one set up a legalization date. This is much more open-ended. I don't think it will happen. I thought if I left anybody out, if anybody's left off the list, I'm sure that.
You did. That's okay. I already know you. Okay. Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you. The chair will call Representative O'Connor.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee, Representative John T. O'Connor, because there's another John O'Connor in the House, and I represent Derry, and I'm also the chairman of Environmental Ag, and I'm here in support. As you can see, I'm also a co-sponsor of this bill, and I'm going to take a few moments of your time to explain the process. As Representative Christian had said, that I was also involved in a particular field trip. Well, I'm also on the NCSL, which is the National Conference of State Legislators, and also on CIRL. CIRL is the State Ag and Rural Leaders. We had the opportunity to study Colorado and also Washington State. And we decided that those would be the first ones that initiated the legalization of marijuana. Washington State did not have marijuana before they legalized marijuana. The states of Maine and Mass, they've come forward, but I want to go back to those two states there. And the process of those states is the importance of Colorado coming out, and they made a lot of mistakes. Following up from Washington, and then learning from Washington that their process took what was good from Colorado, found out what was wrong from Colorado and improved upon it. And I think that's very important that we, as a state, develop a commission so once marijuana does become legalized, that we have a process in place. The process that we had taken at both locations was basically a visitation to the growers, which is isolated, then into the manufacturing and the processing, which is also isolated, and then into the retailers. And in that process, in the study of the whole avenue, was the strict chain of custody that is imposed on both of the locations. In addition to the chain of custody, we studied the taxation of both locations. We studied the issue that happened in Colorado, which they neglected to look at childproofing and packaging. Washington State addressed that. They addressed coloring and so forth of that because marijuana isn't always smoked. A lot of it is with edibles and infusions with various liquids, and it's also a combination of CBD along with THC, which gets rid of the euphoric aspect of marijuana. Next, we met with the Department of Safety, especially in Washington State, with the disappearance of the drug dealers on the corner. That was one of the biggest things that they pushed, is the fact that it became controlled and people that were buying it knew what they were buying versus what they were getting off the streets. We went to the Department of Revenue after that. There is still issues with federal laws and not using credit cards and so forth, but in some states where they have tribal communities, they have tribal banks. The state of Washington, actually, we met with both the Senate House and the House of Representatives, actually joked about that they were actually laundering the money because the taxation was so high in the state of Washington that those areas that had to deliver, they delivered on a once a week basis, cash basis, brought it to the State House, paid it to the Department of Revenue, and then they deposited the money, a federal bank. So basically, I just want to say that's the process that we visited, and I know it's very short, but the process that's outlined here in the commission would address a lot of those issues there, and I think it's better to be ahead of the game instead of playing catch up afterwards. So that concludes my testimony, and I thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Representative. Are there any questions? Senator Gannon?
You just made one comment that bothered me. You said once it becomes legalized, it becomes legalized. Maybe the commission will decide, possibly. It's not already a fourth. Have you already decided where you're going? Or would it, someone like me have a chance in the commission? And then I could decide maybe this isn't good.
That would be true. I mean, my only purpose of that is that I have two relatives. They live in Canada. And they've been on marijuana for one of them is over 8 years. So I give them that by now. So that's why I've been in favor of this here. That's why I helped push the medical marijuana going through there. But I also see the legalization and the benefit of that. Taking it off the streets as far as them dealing it with various coke powders and so forth.
Would someone like me, I'm sorry, Madam Chair, thank you. Anybody? Would someone like me have a place in the commission where I probably believe opposite you?
Absolutely.
So it's not preordained what you're going to come out with as a result.
That was my opinion, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Are there any further questions? Senator French.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Representative. Reading here, findings are supposed to be in by December 1st of this year. Is that ample time?
I believe the committee gets together and they can do it, whoever chairperson sets it up, that the studies that are already out there using Colorado and using Washington and Maine and using Massachusetts and pulling that all together, if they do the due diligence, I don't see why not.
Great, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
The chair will call Representative Olney.
Good morning. Thank you very much. Representative Susan Elmy, Grafton 13, City of Lebanon. Once chair of Ways and Means, which is important to this bill, still a member of Ways and Means. I signed in / Ways and Means, but the person who should have been here, I think, is away. And so, you can take me with a grain of salt, if you will. But we passed this, I think, all of us thinking that someday legalization would happen. And that if it happened, we better get our act together. And when I was chair last, two terms ago, we had a bill from criminal justice that passed by a large majority there that said legalize and tax marijuana. And it didn't say anything else. So they sent it to our committee next. And I looked at that and worked out a list of 8 agencies that would probably be affected if it was legalized. We had a hearing which ended up going about 6 hours, in which each of those agencies came in and answered a number of questions. How would this affect you? What would you have to change? What kinds of staffing would it require? What kinds of laws would have to be changed? On down the list, I can't remember all of them at this point. And they only had a week to think about this, so they were early on thinking about it. But we had testimony from each of those agencies, which was very relevant to the question of what you have to do if you're going to legalize, and they needed a lot more time to think this through. So my personal position is that I don't want to see it legalized before we have a commission like this. And if the commission had so many problems with it, as we did after they had only had a week to think about it, that the legislature would decide we can't get into this, then that would be a result of it too. There are people supporting this that both want to see legalization of marijuana and don't want to see legalization of marijuana. And there's also, at that point, Colorado had only been legalized for 3 months, 2 months. They have a lot more time dealing with the problems it creates, trying to work through hacking issues, which I think are missing here. Just personally, and not from my committee, I was not really thinking about it very much at the time. I was just thinking, oh yeah, we need to do this. There are already 22 members of this commission. I would add someone from the Banking Association, because they're one of the biggest problems that haven't been resolved, besides the one of how do you figure out whether someone is impaired on the road. And also, I'd answer the question that was asked very differently about the timing of this. Having been through a number of really big commissions, the governor has to pick most of these people. The governor has an awful lot to do, and as a person that is in charge of trying to find people, and it can take a very long time. We had a very large commission for driving a number of years ago, and that commission went 3 years probably because the budget kept going down. It was a great recession. But also because it had taken, even though we had a list of people we'd like to see in most of it, they had to go through the associations and get them to think who do they want. I don't think that they can get the commission together before the end of summer, probably. And so I would like to see, I'm not sure why they put in an effective date of repeal of July 1, 2018. I'd like to see them given until July 1, 2018 to write the report, which is on line 19 of page 2. That would be a minimal change, and they could, if they could get the appointing of the commission done that quickly, then they could turn it out on December 1 or 17. But it doesn't seem likely to me they can have the kind of discussions they'll need. I imagine that they'd be breaking up into topic areas and then reporting back to each other with a commission at large. That's essentially what we do with this driving commission, which was also complicated. So that's That's only my personal recommendation. It just occurred to me I haven't talked to Representative Major about it much yet.
Thank you very much, Representative. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you. The chair will call Erica Golfer. Erica, it looks like G-O-L-F-E-R.
I think she actually looks like
She left?
Yes.
Same with the last person who wanted to speak, has spoken. Yes?
And signed the sheet that is far.
Yes, but you did not sign you wanted to speak.
Oh, I'm sorry.
If you'd like to speak, please come forward and keep your, if you can, your comments very brief. We've had a lot of testimony on this morning.
I appreciate that. Thank you for allowing me to testify. My name is Dennis Goddard. I live in Hopkinton, and I wanted to very briefly touch on something because I know that you're hearing a lot today. One of the things that you're weighing, I know, is the impact, the message that gets sent to young people on these kinds of policies. And even forming a study committee, I think we can agree, send some kind of a message. And I wanted to relate you very briefly my own young person's experience, not any longer young, but I was once. Back in eighth grade, I remember that in health class, they started teaching us about various different substances, their effects, the dangers thereof. I remember that one of the substances they talked about was marijuana. I was shocked. One thing I knew was I wanted nothing to do with this. I began to hear more. Kids hear things. They talk about things. They have magazines, all kinds of things. To get found out, I was nerdy, so I did some research and tried to find actual studies with double blinds and that sort of thing, and more came to the conclusion that my government was giving me a very spun story that just wasn't true. And that informed a lot of my feelings about government from that day to this. But as far as what happens in life, it was shortly after that, somewhere around late part of middle school, first part of high school, that I tried experimenting with marijuana myself, since the research I could find suggested it wasn't that big of a problem. What happens when a child who's in middle or high school starts experimenting with marijuana? In my case, I got admitted to the University of Wisconsin in Madison, where I majored in chemical engineering, and then got my double major simultaneously in computer science, and now work at the largest database company in the world. We own all your data. I would say that a significant fraction of the people that I was in school with in the chemical engineering and computer science departments were also using marijuana. For all of us, the most dangerous, destructive thing to society that could have happened would have been had law enforcement had any contact with us. So I'd ask you to consider that deliberately. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony this morning. Are there any questions for Mr. Goddard? Seeing none, thank you. Okay, the last person who signed up to speak has spoken. Does anybody else want to add something new? And you are?
Amanda Rimmel. I actually didn't realize I was supposed to sign up to speak.
Okay, come on down and just make sure you identify yourself for the record. And again, we've heard a lot of testimony on this issue, so if you could just be very concise. Your name is Amanda?
Amanda Renault. I came down here from Littleton, New Hampshire. My name is Amanda Renault. I wanted to speak on behalf of cannabis for people with PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. As a child, I would find myself trying to cope with symptoms. With things like prescription pills that were not prescribed to me. That's how I tried to deal with said symptoms. Being a cannabis user, I do not use prescribed drugs. I have no lack of quality of life. And I Yeah, so I just, it really helps and it benefits, and being somebody with post-traumatic stress disorder, if I didn't use or consume cannabis, I wouldn't be able to sit here right now and speak with you.
Okay, thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions for Ms. Lott? Seeing none, thank you very much. Okay, seeing everyone who wanted to speak has spoken, we're going to go ahead. No, Mr. Freeman, you did not sign up to speak. Nope, not on this one. Do you want to?
Is my name on there?
Nope.
I definitely signed a piece of paper.
Okay, well, I don't have it, so no problem. We can work that one out.
Unfortunately, I missed most of the testimony due to having to move my car downtown.
Okay, but you didn't check your ones to speak.
So I apologize.
Okay, go ahead.
My bad.
Mr. Freeman, you've been here enough. You know how this works.
Anyway, regarding the study committee, I think that we absolutely need to study this closely. There's been a lot of misinformation that has been proffered by various different parties, mostly the chiefs of police. I've heard it from some of the senators and the representatives as well, and it's understandable why people would be misinformed. There have been decades of propaganda about this particular plant. So a sensible policy, of course, would be to look very closely. What are the facts? What can we actually learn from the history of the use of this plant, and what's the truth? I think having a study committee will get closer to it. I don't know if anyone testified against this, but I've seen the chiefs of police testify against study committees in the area of prostitution, and I just don't understand why anybody would be against looking closely at an issue like this. So that's all I have to say. Thanks for listening.
Thank you very much, Mr. Freeman. Are there any questions? No? Okay. Good. Thank you very much. We're going to go ahead and close the public hearing on House Bill 212.
Good.